Yeah, so in the previous video, we discussed GPT version 1, which was a unidirectional transformer model where the pre-training task was the next word prediction. So it was processing the inputs in a leftward fashion, like from left to right. And BERT is a transformer that is a bidirectional one. So BERT stands for bidirectional encoder representations from transformers. So BERT was developed around 2018 by Google Research. And like I said before, the main concept is this bidirectional nature. So the bidirectional pre-training using masking that is not going from left to right, but it's just randomly masking. It's essentially a very simple concept. I will have a slide on that illustrating how that works. So the main architecture is essentially identical to the original transformer and GPT. So both are based on the original transformer paper with the multi-head attention and so forth, except now that they have this bidirectional masking, which is also known as closed task. There was a paper on that that they reference. And they have two pre-training approaches. One is this bidirectional masking, and one is the next sentence prediction. So they have a binary prediction task where they show the model two sentences, and the model has to predict whether sentence B, so if you have two sentences, A and B, the model has to predict whether B is indeed the next sentence in a document or whether it's a random sentence. And I will also have a slide illustrating that. So here, this is just the overview, and we will talk a little bit more in detail in the following slides. So let's take a look at BERT in more detail now. So starting at the bottom here, what are the inputs? How do the inputs to BERT look like? So here's a figure from the original paper, and at the top are the tokens as inputs. So for instance, imagine you have a sentence, sentence one called "My dog is cute," and then the second sentence is "He likes playing," so this is sentence two. And yeah, you can see there's already some tokenization going on. So each token is essentially one word. And you can also see that certain verbs like playing, they become play and then as a separate token, ing. So there's also some sort of pre-processing or stemming going on. These inputs are then augmented by a special classification token and a sentence separator. And then they are going through a process called a word piece model, basically to produce so-called word piece embeddings. It's just a particular way of creating embeddings. We won't discuss this in detail, but if you're interested, this refers to this paper here. So it's just a different method of obtaining embeddings. So now that you have, let's say, these token embeddings, like a real valued vectors, like going from the words to the real valued vectors, then there are also these segment embeddings. So they're also real valued vectors essentially. So for the first sentence, you have the same segment embeddings for each position, and then the same is true for the second sentence. So if this is sentence two here. So you have something that denotes whether the word embedding or token embedding comes from the first or the second sentence, or which segment essentially. Then there are also these position embeddings. So you maybe recall from the original transformer paper, there were like these sinusoidal embeddings. So there's also a form of a position embedding here. And these all, like the token embedding, segment embedding, and position embedding, they all get added up together. So they are summed. And these are then the inputs to the transformer block, like the multi-head attention. And in general, so using these inputs, there are pre-training tasks, and the pre-training tasks are executed on two data sets. So they have this book corpus data set, which consists of 800 million words. And in addition to that, so that was also used in GPT. In addition to that, they also use, in GPT they said it was 7,000 books, if I recall correctly, corresponding to 800 million words. In addition to that, they also use the Wikipedia data set consisting of 2,500 million words, so 2.5 billion words. Then these pre-training tasks are the MASP language model that I mentioned earlier and the next sentence prediction. So they have two different training tasks here. So let's take a look at these pre-training tasks. Starting with pre-training task number one, the masked language model. So how this works is that randomly 15% of the words in the input are marked. So sometimes you also see that people say they are masked, but I call them marked because not all of them are actually masked. So imagine you have an input sentence like this. Let's say a quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog. So you would randomly select words like with 15% probability, so 15% of the words are selected. Let's say in this case we select the word fox. Then 80% of the time the marked words are replaced with a mask token, 10% of the time they are replaced with a random word, and 10% of the time they are left as they are. So sometimes this one will become mask, sometimes this will become coffee or any other word, so just a random word, and sometimes it will just stay fox. And the model, the task of the model is to predict the correct word, so which one goes in here. So it has to predict if it's masked, it has to predict the right word, but also if it's coffee, it has to predict the right word. It just sees this, but it doesn't know whether it's correct or not, because it could also be that it's already correct. So still the model has to kind of think in that way whether it should be, which word should go in there. So this is one pre-training task, and this is what makes the model in a sense also bidirectional, because there is no left to right notion. It's essentially just picking random tokens here or words that have to be predicted. And in this way, it's also self-supervised, right? Because you don't really have to have a human labeling this. I mean, you know the word because you have the complete sentence, so you just remove the word and let the model predict it back in a way. So here's another example. So let's say we replace this word with the mask. So this is this 80% scenario of the 15% marked words. And then it goes through the BERT model and then it has to predict the right word. So there will be softmax function, for example, and if we have a vocabulary size of 30,000, there will be 30,000 probability values here, like summing up to 1, and you will then select the one with the highest predicted probability, for instance a fox, and this one would be then the one that the model predicts. The second task is this next sentence prediction. So this is a balanced binary classification task. The labels are is next and is not next 50% of the time, so it's balanced. So what they do is they take an input sentence. So for instance, the man went to the store. So that's actually an example they used in the paper. And then the second sentence is he bought a gallon mask milk. So also notice that they combine both pre-training tasks. So the next sentence prediction also includes the masking. And then this is a case where these are A and B are actual sentences that follow each other in the original documents. So here the true label is next. And at the bottom is a case, an example where the label is not next. So they have again the same, the man walks into the store, went to the store, it's masked here. And then the second sentence is penguin are flightless birds. So here this would be an example where A and B are sentences that follow each other in the original document, and here that's not true. And the model has to recognize whether these sentences follow each other or not. And it's another way that the model can learn how to understand text. So here's an illustration of the pre-training procedure and the fine-tuning to the downstream tasks from the original BERT paper. So on the left-hand side, they illustrate the pre-training process, where we have now these masked sentences, sentence A and sentence B. And the task is, there are two tasks. One is the next sentence prediction. So we have this classification token, right? And then it has to predict whether it's the next sentence or not. And then we also predict these masked words. So if we had a masked, let's say a masked token here, let's call it M, it's also predicting which word goes in there, these marked or masked tokens. So that's the pre-training. And then after pre-training, we can fine-tune our models for other tasks. For instance, here they have a question answer task as an example, where they provide the test, the question here on the left-hand side, and then a paragraph to the right-hand side. So the question is referring or asking something about that paragraph, and then the model here generates an answer. But you can also fine-tune it for classification. For example, you could concatenate, let's say, two sentences here, and then you have a classification, let's say the movie review classification. So this is just the illustration. And remember when we talked about the GPT, I mentioned that there are two different ways for working with downstream tasks. So here's again the general training procedure for transformers. There's first this unsupervised or self-supervised pre-training, the pre-training on large unlabeled data sets. So like here on the left-hand side, this is done on unlabeled data, whereas this fine-tuning here on downstream tasks is done on smaller labeled data sets. And for these downstream tasks, there are really two different approaches though. So fine-tuning is what they mainly talk about in this BERT paper. This is the approach where they update the whole model, so all the parameters. But there's also this feature-based approach that I mentioned earlier, and they also do some experiments with that in the BERT paper. So let's just go over these two also as an example. So the fine-tuning is essentially by adding a classification layer. So you have, for example, a classification layer, which could be, if you have, let's say, different words or different classes, you add that to the model at the end. So if, for instance, your model is trained to do the next sentence prediction, the output layer would be just one value, or it could be also two. It depends on how you implement binary classification. But let's say you want to train that for a different task where you have, let's say, 10 different classes or 100 different classes. So you can add a fully connected layer to the end and then have softmax probabilities and using a cross entropy loss to train that model. And when you do that, you would essentially update the whole model. So here, this is just a screenshot of the original transformer encoder just for illustration, but this would be essentially the BERT encoder, which would look similar, where you have this bidirectional training with a 15% marking, where then 80% are masked, 10% are replaced by random words, and 10% are left as they are of these tokens. And yeah, so the fine-tuning really is updating the whole model. After pre-training and you fine-tune it for classification, you update all the model parameters here. It's like a training end-to-end. The other approach, let me first illustrate. So regarding this fine-tuning approach, here are the results from the paper. So they compared their paper, for example, to other methods like ELMO. We haven't talked about ELMO yet. There are too many things already to talk about in this lecture, so I didn't exhaustively cover all the models. But we talked about the OpenAI GPT model here, and you can see that both the small and the large BERT version, so they have a base and a large version, are performing better than BERT on several tasks, actually on all tasks here, if you consider the larger one, I think also the smaller one. So they outperform, for instance, the unidirectional GPT model here by their bidirectional training with these masked language models and the next sentence prediction. And this is for the fine tuning then to these different tasks. So each of them is a different labeled data set. You can see here the sizes of these data sets. So this is all done by fine tuning, for instance, like adding fully connected layers and then fine tuning the whole model. Now the other approach is the feature-based training. And nowadays I think this is the way more popular approach. So when I look at different people using BERT, this is by far more popular. There's also, for example, something called a ProtBERT, where people did something similar with proteins, where they trained a BERT model on amino acid sequences, like sequences of proteins. And then after training, they only looked at the embeddings, and then they looked at how the embeddings cluster, and they trained classifiers on these embeddings, and they found that these embeddings are very information-rich. They contain a lot of information about proteins. So the idea behind this feature-based training is, after the pre-training, you keep the BERT model frozen, so you don't update anything. And you, if you have a new data set, let's say your movie review data set, you just use that BERT model to create the embeddings. So you would, for instance, download a pre-trained BERT model that has been trained on a large corpus in this pre-training fashion, like using self-supervised learning, and then you create all these embeddings for all your examples in your data set, in your smaller training set, and then you train a new model just on these embeddings. So you treat these embeddings as the input features to your model. This model could be an RNN, it could be logistic regression, could be a multilayer perceptron, could be a one-dimensional convolutional network. It can be anything you like. But most often these days I see people just training a simple multilayer perceptron or logistic regression. So it's essentially supervised learning, just like the supervised learning you learned about in this class, using now these embeddings as input. Similar to how an RNN can use word embeddings, you can now use these embeddings from the BERT model as input to any other model. And also they looked at that in the paper, and they actually found that this can perform quite well too, so without any fine-tuning. Not quite as good as the fine-tuning, so the fine-tuning approach again is here, but quite good. So here, these are these feature-based approaches, and you can see that when they concatenated the last four hidden layers, the outputs from the last four hidden layers of the BERT model, and then they trained a bidirectional LSTM model on that, they found that this performance is actually almost the same as the fine-tuned BERT model. So fine-tuning, I would say, is more work because you have to load the whole model into memory and then update the whole model. And nowadays, many language models can be quite large. I think BERT is like somewhat around 100, I mean, the small one is 100 million parameters already. The larger one, I think, might be around 300 or something. So in that way, it's kind of expensive to train the model, especially if you only have access, let's say, to a CPU or only one GPU. So in this way, this feature-based approach is way more attractive because you can just generate these embeddings running the model one time, and you don't have to worry about training the BERT model, just working with the embeddings. All right, so this was the BERT model in a nutshell, and in the next video we will come back to the GPT model, because there was, in 2019, 1 year after BERT, an update to the GPT model.